We are curious and we love mysteries. And one of the reasons for us to look for cures for diseases is mystery. And the stem cell is one of the mysterious fields that are going to grow in the future, and it's going to be one of the cornerstones of future medicine. And that's why we conducted our study on it, so we hope to be a part of it. One thing we all have to know about stem cells is that there are mainly two types: the embryonic stem cells and the adult stem cells.
The embryonic are achieved from the fifth day of embryogenesis, from the blastocyst, inner man, and these cells can differentiate into every type of the cells in the body.
While the adult ones, they are restricted to the organ source, and they only differentiate to their organ source types. Our cells, the mesenchymal ones, are not like the classic ones from the adult tissue. They're from the embryonic ones, and so these cells are promising. The trials of chondrogenesis has never been made on them. They have only been made on hair cells. Our objective is obviously, as I said, it's chondrogenesis of these cells. And also identifying the protocol growth factors that prove to be affected in these cells also. So it's a methodology, it's an experimental study. We had a literature review concerning these growth factors. Who seem to be working on the mesenchymal ones, the adult ones, and we selected ones to be used in the study, and also to be sure that this result took place, we had histological morphology study and also PCR. So we started this all with culture of the cells of origin, the embryonic derived mesenchymal ones. We expanded them in flasks. In special incubators,
we use, and when they reach a level of confluency where the cells are packed up like this, we obtain 500,000 cells for every condition we have four conditions, and we centrifuge them in this tube and let them for one day to grow a 3D pellet culture, which is very useful for the histology extraction, and you will see later on.
At day zero, we added the growth factors, which are TGF-beta-1, and the mixture of three different growth factors, and then a control.
And we have chondrocyte media for every condition, so it can also help.
These are our cells, so you can see how they look like at day zero. And after we were done with the experiment, it took actually 27 days. We had already taken samples from early days and late days, and at the end of the study, we conducted molecular biology studies and histological. The PCR needs to go through RNA extraction before it takes place. And it's a very easy concept. It's simple. We compared the control and the induced cells. We extracted RNA from them. And then the mRNA, which is single-stranded, as we all know, has to go through a cDNA synthesis so we can make a double-strand of it. And then the cDNA enters the PCR machine to undergo a DNA amplification process. This DNA amplification goes through, first the machine freezes the head, and then the strands will split, and this will result in denaturation. And when the strands split, the head will go down again. And primers, we have primers for specific genes, for every gene we have to know on the genesis. They annealed on their coat, and they synthesize new strands, and with every cycle we had duplicates. And at the end, we had about 40 cycles. And there was a fluorescent added to the mixture. This fluorescent attached to the results, and it let the PCR machine detect the extent of expression of these cells inside the results. Now I will leave you with the PCR. These are the machines we use. This is the RNA quantification machine, the cDNA synthesizer, and the PCR machine.
Yeah.
I'll leave you with the results of my friends now.
Thank you. I'll be talking about the results. The first part of the results is to know which condition works best. So to understand these diagrams, you should know that this is TGF-beta-1, beta-3 mix and control. And this was, we are going to compare the results of day 10 and day 24, which was almost the last day of the experiment. So what we do exactly is we compare gene expression, which is like COMP and SOX9. They're both induced and they're found in chondrocyte, SOX9 in the nucleus and COMP in the matrix. Valix2 is found in osteocyte nucleus and collagen1 in the osteocyte matrix. You might wonder why we added osteogenic gene expression. That's because as you know, in the process of osteogenesis, it first goes through chondrogenesis. We want to know if we went too far with it, okay? So if you look here, we would compare the control with TGF-beta1, which was the highest. It shows high uptake degradation, which is a good sign. That means chondrogenesis has started. And also SOX9. Without SOX9, there's no chondrogenesis. This is the nucleus. It should be there. It was very high upregulated, and that's a very good thing. In Valix2, we found that the mix is going high, which means that the mixture of the growth factors that we added, it kind of went into the osteogenesis direction instead of chondrogenesis. Collagen 1, they were all low, and that's not bad. That's actually good because it's more of an osteogenic marker than a gene than an osteochondrogenic. Okay, on day 24, the results are showing that TGF-beta1 have also increased COMP as well as beta1. If you find it was 173 year and now it's 376. Okay, and SOX9 also had upregulation of beta3. It wasn't high there. Both signs show that beta1 and beta3 have induced chondrogenesis. But beta-1 was better because it started earlier, okay? So it was the best in our experiment. Granix-2, we found that beta-3 as well induced Granix-2, which means that beta-3 as it induced chondrogenesis, it also induced osteogenesis, okay? So to conclude our gene expression results, we would like to say that beta-1 plays a major role, definitely. And as you might think that beta-3 did as well, but we think that beta-3 went in both osteogenic and chondrogenic, not very specific. Mixing was more of an osteogenic growth factor, which means that it's not as significant as we wanted it to be. Okay, this could not be confirmed until it was repeated at least in the data. Now I will leave you with the second part of the data collection tools of histology.
I'm going to continue the histological analysis. We use two stains mainly. We use log section invert and embedding method for the cell pellets. However, the cell pellets were very tiny, but we managed to obtain some data for the histological results. Now, the first slide shows shows the cells before adding any growth factors. That was on day zero. So we can see we just added the chondrogenic media. So we see that on magnification 20. We see the cell-to-cell interaction, we see the round morphology, and also the 3D pellet response assessor. And to make sure, that was on T-tex and you see in the stain. And when adding Alsham blue stain, which is a very specific stain for chondrogenic differentiation, we also don't see any signs of differentiation has started yet, which is good, because this is day zero. We didn't add any growth factors yet. Now on day 21, we have two conditions here. That's the control condition where we didn't add any growth factor, and that's the TGF-beta1 condition. Now we can see that some cell clusters have formed already here, and there's some chondrogenic matrix started to form also. Now when we stain day 21 cell pellets with Alsaati blue stain, which is, as we said, very specific for chondrogenic differentiation, we can see that on TGF-beta1 condition, the matrix has formed, chondrogenic matrix. It stains blue, and also cell clusters are seen. Now this slide just show you that it compares between day zero control, where there wasn't any chondrogenic differentiation yet, and that's day 21 control also. And here, day 21 induced with TGF-beta1. So cell clusters are larger, and there's matrix, chondrogenic matrix. And in conclusion, the histology backs up the PCR results we've seen with Nouf. And we recommend that whoever wants to do future work about chondrogenic differentiation of human embryonic stem cells, that they would study more the effect of TGF-beta1, because we see that was the most potent growth factor in our experiment. That was about the experimental part. Now I'll continue with the questionnaire that we conducted about stem cell knowledge. We distributed a questionnaire among 52 third-year medical students, female only,
and we were interested in learning how much they know about stem cell and their interests and Islamic beliefs about it. These are the most significant results. Now, when we asked them about how much do they know about stem cells, 76.9 said that they know very little knowledge. And when we asked them about their, if they're interested in attending some workshops or lectures about stem cell within the next 2 years, 94.2 said yes, they are really interested in this field. And when we asked about the Islamic beliefs, there's any Islamic limitation for using disposed, unneeded embryonic stem cells in clinical research, 42.3 said that there are Islamic limitations, but actually there isn't any. And what was really surprising that 96.2 would agree to be treated by stem cell in the future, although they think there are some limitations. Now that shows that there's a very big lack in their knowledge about stem cell. So what we recommend that they we have to spread awareness more about stem cells knowledge and Islamic beliefs and therapeutic point of view. So we recommend that the stem cell department would conduct a seminar every semester, for example, for medical students, just to learn the medical the basics of the stem cell. And we recommend to include some lectures of basic stem cell knowledge on in our curriculum, the first two basic science years. We'd like to ask to thank whoever who helped us to stand here today and present this. The stem cell team, on top of them, Dr. Abdullah Dahmaj, their supervisor, and Dr. Mayna Mahabin, and Dr. Muna Safadi as well for her support, and Dr. Ali for his helped us a lot in the histological analysis, Mr. Mani for learning, teaching us PCR and lab technique, and Dr. Raed for his consistent support. And we also like to thank Dr. Amna, for whenever we needed help, she was there for us. And Prof. Mustafa, for allowing the differentiation to start there in their lab. And all our third year medical students who helped us in participating with the question. Our conferences are in Vancouver style. we wouldn't forget Dr. Ahmed, our supervisor, for without him, we wouldn't do anything. We wouldn't do what we've done. He was really supportive and very, we're very grateful for we found this picture.
Any
questions? If you have any questions, please.
Thank you very much. I have some questions. To start with, I think it's very good work and it's very nicely presented and very clear. Everything is so clear. I mean, it seems that you know what you are talking about. But I believe you should have put some patient-oriented research into it in the introduction or anywhere to tell us the importance of the stem cell for future medicine. I mean, it's a future. It's a medicine now.
It's actually the future.
Yeah, now after. So I believe, especially the control side, how it is relevant to the disease or relevant to the some congenital abnormalities we have here in the community. So I think this is always what is the aim. Medicine, any revolution in medicine is how the application is in finding disease in humans. So that
I believe they did this a little bit in the slide, in the second slide and third slide, where they showed where the embryonic stem cells are derived from and where the other stem cells are derived from and how they differentiate. And obviously, if you can take these embryonic stem cells and how they showed in the slide, you can put them into the dish, and then you can derive drive these undifferentiated cells into various lineages and then reconstitute these different tissues, then I think they touched upon this.
No, I don't think anything. Did you see it? You understand. I did very well. Yeah, it's just one of those. The other thing I just wanted to know, you got the stem cells from the placenta that already processed?
No, no. Yeah, they were from Denmark, from the other guy.
Because in National Lab, they have stem cells from the placenta.
No, that's different. Yeah, these are adult, they're more, they're not pluripotentate. They cannot be treated with all.
They don't.
They don't. The placenta one. And these ones are pluripotentate. They can be treated with all type of problems.
So those are from already existing. The other thing I wanted to ask what is the actual implication of this? That we put growth factor, this is TE1, in the dish to promote growth. Then I take this and put it in the joint of the people, so people resist the arthritis we have. I think that was very important to mention.
I'm not sure you have to say. And that was done, and it's a very challenging job to link the basic sciences with what is its application would be perhaps after much more research. Thank you very much. Please introduce yourself. Dr. Amer Mahmood will introduce, but...
I'm Dr. Riyadh. I'm just working with them.
Please introduce yourself.
Can I get some?
Yeah, sure.
I'm Dr. Nourhan Elshamma. I'm the director of stem cell unit. First of all, I would like to thank. It was the first opportunity for us and first students on the third year, and they were actually a very good example and positive. And they are active. And also, I would like also Dr. Amer. He was really, really so encouraging them and support them and guide them every single day and every single all the experiment. Also, I would like to add, we are doing in a regular basis, every summer time, research and training for all the students and even for postgraduate or master students training in our lab. So everybody's welcome in our lab.
Thank you very much. And now we will break for a tea and coffee break. You're all welcome for 5 to 7 minutes. Can you be back to complete in time by 12? Okay? Thank you. So come back by 15 minutes to 11.